Dear believers, dear Muslims, assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Allahu akbar. Allahu akbar. Allahu akbar. Allahu akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Hayya 'alas-salah. Hayya 'alas-salah. Hayya 'alal-falah. Hayya 'alal-falah. Allahu akbar. Allahu akbar. La ilaha illallah.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به عز وجل أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وبعد أيها المسلمون with God's name the merciful benefactor the merciful redeemer The perfect praise belongs to God, the guardian revolver, the cherished keeper, sustainer of all the worlds, of all the systems of knowledge. We render all praises to him, and we seek his help, and we ask for his forgiveness. We put our complete faith and trust in him, mighty and sublime as he. I bear witness that there is nothing worthy of worship except Allah alone, the one and only. There is none like unto him. And I bear witness that Prophet Muhammad is Allah's servant, messenger prophet to all of mankind. We ask Allah's peace, his blessings, his highest exhortations be upon Prophet Muhammad, upon his family, his companions, the righteous all. On you, O Muslim, be peace. We greet you again in the beautiful language of the Quran. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Al-Mubad, and what follows of this excellent salutation or salute to our Prophet Muhammad, the prayers and the peace be on him. Dear Muslim, I advise you as well as myself to fear Allah and obey Allah. Have taqwa, have the highest regard for God and obey God. Dear believers, our talk for this Jumu'ah khutbah or lecture is Al-Nisa or the women. Al-Nisa is the fourth Surah of the Quran. This surah is called The Women, but it is addressing the men. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is God, the sacred and the mighty, says in his holy book, the Quran, O humanity, or ya ayyuhal nas. O humanity, reverence your guardian Lord who created you from a single person, created of like nature, his mate, Zawj. And from them came scattered like seeds, countless men and women. fear Allah, through whom you request your mutual rights, and reverence the wounds that bore you. For Allah ever watches over you. Now we're going to be reading some ayahs from Surah An-Nisa, the women. And then we'll come back, inshallah. Time willing, we'll make some comments on it. Allah says, if you feel that you cannot be, if you fear that you cannot be able to deal justly with the orphans, marry women of your choice, two or three or four. But if you fear that you cannot be, but if you fear that you cannot be able to deal justly with them, then only one, or a captive that your right hands possess. That will be more suitable to prevent you from doing injustice. Allah accepts the repentance of those who do evil in ignorance and repent soon afterwards. To them will Allah turn in mercy, for Allah is full of knowledge and wisdom. Of no effect is the repentance of those who continue to do evil until death faces one of them. And he says, now have I repented indeed, nor of those who die rejecting faith. For them have we prepared a punishment most grievous. O you who believe, you are forbidden to inherit women against their will, nor should you treat them with harshness, that you may take away part of the dowry you have given them, except where they have been guilty of open lewdness. On the contrary, live with them on a footing of kindness and equity. If you take a dislike to them, it may be that you dislike a thing, and Allah brings about through it a great deal of good. O you who believe, eat not up your property among yourselves and vanities, but let there be among you traffic and trade by mutual goodwill. Nor kill or destroy yourselves. For sure Allah has been to you most merciful. If you stay away from the most hateful or evil things, which are forbidden to do, we will remove out of you all the evil in you and admit you to a gate of great honor. And never be jealous of those things that Allah has bestowed his gift more freely on some of you than others. To men is allowed what they earn, and women what they earn. But ask Allah for his bounty, for Allah has full knowledge of all things. Husbands are the protectors and maintainers of their wives, because Allah has given the one more strength than the other, and because they support them from their means. Therefore, the righteous women are devoutly obedient and guard in the husband's absence. what Allah would have them guard. As to those women whose part you fear disloyalty and ill conduct, admonish them first. Next, refuse to share their beds. And last, spank them lightly. But if they return to obedience, seek not against them means of annoyance, for Allah is most high, great above you all. If you fear a breach between the both of them, appoint two arbiters, one from his family and the other from hers. If you wish for peace, Allah will cause their reconciliation. For Allah has full knowledge and is acquainted with all things. Serve Allah and join not any partners with him. And do good to parents, relations, orphans, those in need, neighbors who are near, neighbors who are strangers, the companions by your side, the wayfarer you meet, and what your right hand possesses. For Allah loves not the arrogant, the vainglorious. Allah forgives not that partners to be set up with him, but he forgives anything else to whom he pleases. To set up partners with Allah is to devise a sin most heinous indeed. Wherever you are, death will find you out. Even if you are in towers built up strong and high. If some good befalls them, they say this is from Allah. But if evil, they say this is from you, O Prophet. Say, all things are from Allah. But what has come to these people that they fail to understand a single fact? We come to the end. Whatever good old man happens to you, it's from Allah. But whatever evil happens to you is from your own soul. And we have sent you as a messenger to instruct mankind. And enough is Allah for a witness. Whoever recommends and helps a good cause becomes a partner in it. And whoever recommends and helps an evil cause shares in its burden. And Allah has power over all things. Kuli Shayin Qadir. Last ayat. Then we'll sit and come back and make some comments, inshallah. When the angels take the souls of those who die in sin against their souls, they say, "And what plight were you?" They reply, "Weak and oppressed. Were you in the earth?" They say, "Was not the earth of Allah spacious enough for you to move yourselves away from evil?" Such men will find their abode in hell. What an evil refuge. Sadaqallahu al-Azim. Allah the Mighty speaks the truth. That's me. Do what? Allahu Akbar. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. We witness that God is one and that he cares for all of his creation, especially his servants and his messengers. And we witness that Prophet Muhammad as his servant and his messenger and the seal of the prophets and scripture. We salute Prophet Muhammad with the traditional salute of salutation, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the prayers and the peace be on him. So again, We are speaking from the surah An-Nisa, or the women. And as I said earlier, and I'm recapping because our dear brothers are late, so they missed the first part of the talk. We're going to be not aware of what's going on. This surah for An-Nisa is entitled The Women. But interestingly enough, it's addressing the men. That is very interesting. And we're going to read again and make some comments. It says, O humanity, reverence your God and Lord. Ya'ayyuha nas. The word is nas, but in the translation it says humanity. And nas means the thinking people. The people who follow logic to the logical conclusion. That's specific. It says, O humanity, reverence your God and Lord, who created you from a single person, created of like nature, is me. And from them came scattered like seeds, countless men and women. Said, fear Allah, have taqwa of Allah, through whom you request your mutual rights and reverence the wounds that bore you, for Allah ever watches over you. Now many of you may know that this is one of the first ayahs that we use in the marriage khutbah. It's very comprehensive. It said, and scattered like mates, from them came countless men and women. I'm looking for a thing right here. I'm kind of missing it. Yeah, mate. That's the word I'm looking for, mate. See, when you're trying to get married, you're not just looking for a wife, which is a good thing, or a husband, which is a good thing. The word that you're looking for is zawj. That's what it is in Arabic, is zawj. And a zawj is someone that you fuse with. See, that's your mate. You might get married one or two or several times to a wife or a husband, but until you find your mate, your zawj, that's when you're gonna have the one that Allah has put on earth for you. Everything has a mate. Every animal, every insect, every tree, but more importantly, every human being, when Allah created you, it is a mate for you. You just have to make dua and keep doing what's right and don't get weak and just be with anybody and Allah will bless you with your mate. Said, if you fear that you, oh, man, what I'm doing? Excuse me, I'm speedballing. It goes on to say, if you fear that you cannot be able to deal justly with the orphans, marry women of your choice, two or three or four. So this is in the fourth surah, An-Nisa, this is the first injunction from Allah where the man has a reason to have more than one wife. If it's associated with the orphans being victims of their parents, mainly the father getting killed in the wars. So it was a great preponderance of women and not enough men. So Allah is telling the man, it's honorable, yes, to take on the orphans. And if you need help, marry two or three or four. A lot can be said about this, but one thing is for sure. Yes, as a Muslim man, believer, we can have more than one wife. But there should be a very serious, important reason for that. not just arbitrary, not for just lust, not just because you can have it, but have it tied to an honorable reason. And here God showed you that because the orphans don't have adequate family members, especially husbands, then the man takes on more of his share of social responsibility. Because when you get married, you take on your share of social responsibility. So that's what it's saying in here, but it's a lot more. So this would be a strong reason if you choose to take on a second wife. And I say if you do that, more power to you. Because it ain't gonna be easy. Having one is going to be, within its own self, a blessing and a trial. But two, is you really going to get a run for your money. It goes on to say, Allah accepts the repentance of those who do evil in ignorance and repent soon afterwards. To them will Allah turn in mercy, for Allah is full of knowledge and wisdom. And don't we have something that we can relate to for this? The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that when you make your shahadatain, and listen to this, when you take your shahadatain with sincerity, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you for all your past things that you did in ignorance. Because you were being directed and influenced by the shaitan before you became a Muslim. But once you came to understanding in your mind, in your heart, in your mind, your soul, and your field of that, there was no God but Allah, no Allah, and that Muhammad was his messenger, and you took that declaration, if you changed your life from that point on, though you might stumble and fall here and there, but if you struggled, if you fought to live up to that, then Allah will forgive you for all those things that nobody knows what we did besides Allah. Nobody but Allah. Some things they don't know we did, but things happen to us in private, etc. If something happened to you, if you did something, you shouldn't disclose it to nobody. If Allah don't disclose it, you shouldn't disclose it. Don't be telling people what you did, what happened, what you did. That's not important no more. What's important is now that you have taken on the form of ibadah. You're taking on the part of being a worshiper of Allah, one who has faith. Allah already knew you was going to do them things before you was born. You weren't informing Allah enough. He knew you was going to do whatever you was doing that wasn't right. Allah already knew those things. Human frailty. He allowed you to go through all them things so that you could have a more understanding and a more appreciation. When the truth did come to you, nobody could turn you back. But Shaitan has said, he has given up all hope of ever getting you off the track. Once you take that shahadatain, he said, but now he will get you on the small things. When you be neglectful, that's how Shaitan will get you. When you're not aware of the Shaitan, that's how he will get you. Right? He says he will come to you on your right, on your left. He will come right in front of you. He will come from you behind. Why? Because he is the most subtle of all creatures. So that means that we have to be aware of the Shaitan at all times and look at everything that we do or we're involved in and see if Shaitan is influencing that. That's how you deal with the weak schemes of the Shaitan. Being aware of your surroundings and who you're around and where you are at all times and places and things. Never let your guard down. And constantly say when you come in contact with things, a'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. I seek refuge with God from Shaitan, the rejected. A'udhu. Not you, a'udhu, me. But that's our protection. So then it says that of no effect is the repentance of those who continue to do evil until death faces one of them. And he says, now have I repented indeed. Nor are those who die rejecting faith. For them have we prepared a punishment most grievous. So wait until doing everything you want to do. I'll do right later, man. I know I should probably do right. I know my father Muslim, my mother Muslim, my brother Muslim. I was raised up in the church. But man, I love this world. I love this street. I love this dunya. And I know, man, by the time I get to a certain age, I'm going to stop doing this stuff and do what's right. No, you're going to wait till you hit the death, and then you're going to say, I've been witness. There's no God but Allah. That's the same thing Pharaoh did. Pharaoh raised Cain in hell on the land until the last day when Allah started drowning him. And he said, I bear witness that there is no God but Allah. And Muhammad is his man. Too late. Hellfire for you. You have to change. The minute you know that your life is not right for God, that's when you got to start changing your life for God. And calling on God and supplication and dua. The minute you know you ain't right, the minute you know you didn't treat somebody right, you got to ask for Allah's forgiveness then. Because you don't know where and what time and what circumstances that Allah going to send the angel of death to take your soul. And if you're not right, the angel is going to snatch your soul from your throat. You're going to be terrified around 10 people having a good time. Nobody going to see the angel of death but you. What's wrong with him? What's wrong with her? What? Snatch your soul. Do autopsy. Something terrified him. Look at his face on his face. If you're a believer, they see you look like a baby sleeping. He's smiling when you're laying on the gurney. But if you're a disbeliever, hell and damnation starts for you right now. Right now. It says, O you who believe, O you who believe, O you who have faith, O you believe, O you have faith, and Amanu. O you who trust God, you are forbidden to inherit women against their will, nor should you treat them with harshness, that you may take away from them part of the dowry you have given them, except when they have been guilty of open lewdness. On the contrary, live with them on a footing of kindness and equity. Then the dowry is very important. I just heard a person on the radio talking today on the station. This is this time right here, at our time, where she said that in those years, women were not allowed to have their own property. They weren't allowed to have material things, had their own money. But with the advent of the prophet and this revelation, women were allowed to have their own, and that's called a dowry. So a man, before he marries a woman, he has to give her a dowry. He has to give her some type of material something, and that is not to be taken back from her unless she accepts for that to happen. That's a whole another story. But that's where the dowry comes from, the mother. And God says, listen, if you marry, this is really good for you, brother. He said, if you take a dislike to them, meaning the women, it may be that you dislike a thing and Allah brings about through it a great deal of good. But brothers, women can and will get on our nerves. Still treat them good. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring a lot of good through them. If you're married, you know that. I'm married. I'm speaking from a married man. And I stay married. Because I know that none of you, but for so long, can make it out here in this dunya, in this dirty, filthy, corrupt world, if you're a real natural man without a woman. Can't do it. Wasn't created to be that way. Adam alayhi salam, peace be upon him, the prophet, he couldn't do it. In the garden, got everything. Feel something wrong. Ain't something right. Then do I for a mate. And then how will come? Eve, his mate. Starting right on right away. Man and woman, husband and wife. So you got to have a mate. If you got a girlfriend, hey, make it your wife. Because if she's your girlfriend and you're having sex with her, according to the prophet, that's hellfire. If you have sex with her, then marry her. Simple as that. Marry her. So that when you go into her, it'll be an investment for you as opposed to a punishment for you. Simplifies things for you. It said, oh, you who believe, eat not up your property among yourselves and vanities, but let there be among you tijera, traffic and trade, by mutual goodwill, nor kill or destroy yourselves, for sure Allah has been to you most merciful. So we supposed to, Muslim believers, we supposed to make money, and we supposed to rotate among us. We supposed to support one another. See, it says tijera. Tijera means traffic and trade. Come to his business, come to her business, buy from her, buy from him, and don't just better stay in one place. Rotate. And then God says, and don't commit suicide. Do not kill yourself. Do not commit suicide. Because whatever you do in committing suicide, according to the prophet, you'll relive that over and over again. You hang yourself, you'll see yourself being hung over and over again. You burn yourself, you shoot yourself. It don't end. You think it ends because you're killing yourself. No, it's just beginning. This form you're going to be in, it's not going to be nice. So God said, do not destroy yourself. If you stay away from the most hateful and evil things, which are forbidden to do, he will remove out of you all the evil in you and admit you to the gate of great honor. So if you stay away from wrongdoing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make all of this right. If you stay away from wrongdoing, Allah will make all the forces of nature to work on your behalf. Imam W.D. Muhammad said, Allah have mercy on him, he said, Allah will bless you with help from the angels, men and jinn will be working for you. I bear witness. And you don't be in the business I'm in. As long as I've been in business, I ain't never get hurt. I ain't never had no money taken from me. You don't be in this business. You don't let it be no 70 years old like I am and not have no known physical ailments. Ain't on no medication. I ain't on aspirin. I ain't on nothing. My vitals are normal, and that's the angels. That's men and jinn working for you. The jinn work for you? Yes, they work for Prophet Suleiman. Then the jinn work for Suleiman. He was standing on his cane and had them working like I don't know what. And then an ant ate away his cane, and he fell down to his demise. And the jinn said, you mean tell me he wasn't even alive, and I'm working like this for him? Right, so you got jinn working for you if you're doing right that you don't even know. You know you got angels working for you. You know the angels working for you. That's keeping you from getting killed out here every day. Getting ran over by a car. Lady backed up one time. I stepped down on the curb, up the curb, and something told me, you know, it was a lot. And she got in the car, and she excelled right away, excelled. And Allah made her stop right by my leg. If she did one more drive, she'd have messed my leg up for life. And I said, oh, Allah. And the car stopped. And she got up to call, oh, Mr., I'm sorry. And I said, alhamdulillah, no problem. I knew what it was Allah doing it. Then I was driving down C Street, Southeast one time. I got the right of way. Then this pickup truck loaded down with all types of scaffolding and everything. He coming down, I'm going this way, he coming this way, and I see him. He ain't stopping. So I know, I said, if he hit me, I'm gone, broadside. So he got set together. He was in the car with two other guys. And I knew again, and I kept driving, I was saying, alhamdulillah. Because I knew that was Allah. See, that's Allah dispatching his angels for you when you are helpless, when you can't do nothing for yourself, when death is facing you and you can't do nothing, then Allah sends his angels to work on your behalf and men to help you do things. Gardens where rivers flow, that's men and women to help you do things, to help you make it in life. How do I know that? Because that's how my wife do for me. My wife makes everything easy for me. Things that I was not doing and may not have ever done, but she does everything for me. Yeah. Gardens where indeed them rivers flow. So you put everything, all these things in context. And this is a big one right here. Very testing and trying. If you are not submitting to God, and you're not trusting in God, this ayah can be very difficult for you. It says, husbands, that's us brothers. Regiment. See, we are the legs of regiment. We are the legs of society. The women and the children, etc., they are supposed to be able to stand on us like a table, four legs. That's our job. We are the regiment. We are the ones who the women should be able to stand on. So God says, husbands are the protectors. Somebody knock on the door. Hey, baby, get in the habit. Don't get out. Don't even move out the chair. I'm going to the door. Who is it? He said, ain't nobody in there. Right away, he don't notice. Because you intuitively, naturally, Allah has made you the protectors. It's your automatic. If you've been raised right, automatically, you know if anything that's manual or labor or physically, you know that's your job as a man. So Allah said husbands are the protectors and maintainers of their wives. So what you do, brother, it contributes to you maintaining your wife. That's why it's important to get a zawj who has like mind and like nature of you, and she is not high maintenance, and you know you ain't high maintenance. Because how are you going to maintain a high maintenance woman if you're not high maintenance? You can go to the McDonald's to get a Big Mac. She want to go to a high-class restaurant and get a filet mignon and lobster. How many times can you do that? So already you know if you meet her, they ain't your mate. You got to marry somebody that understands your situation and what you can do. When I met my wife, I was in a state in my life I had thousands before, millions before. But when I met her, I was broke. You know what I did? I made a full disclosure. I said, babe, I'm gonna tell you right now, I ain't got nothing. She's still married. Now, that let me know right there, that's my mate. Because I could have married anybody when you got plenty of money. Look at these movie stars and these actors and football players. They would never get the kind of bras they got if they ain't had no money. Very big old tall, 7 foot, 8 foot tall, 18 size shoe, oh, very big old noses, can't hardly speak or nothing. She would never marry him if she didn't know that soon she married him, she gonna be living in a mansion, shopping in the London, riding around the Rolls Royce. That's one of the only reasons that they married. But when somebody marry you, brother, sister, marry you for who you are and what you have. That's your way. Neo just got married last week, right? He got married to his childhood sweetheart. See, that's his mate. When he had nothing, that was his sweetheart. And now he got paper and got money, he ain't go out and marry a Caucasian or go to L.A. and marry some long, pretty haired woman. He married somebody who knew him and he knew her. And she knew him for what he was. And now that he's a millionaire, got plenty of money, that's his mate. So husbands are the protectors and maintainers of their wives, because Allah has given the man more strength than the woman or the other. And because they support them from their means, therefore the righteous women are divinely, devoutly obedient, and God, in the husband's absence, what Allah would have them God. So you get the right woman. She protect you. She don't let nobody get into your space. Nobody come into your private quarters. She don't give up no damaged information. She don't have no unnecessary conversation. Because that's your absence. Because for sure, brother, if you're a strong man, then they're going to crap on your wife. I don't care who you are. You can be in there. President of the United States, you can be a show business, you can be a billionaire. They can't get to you, but they can get to mama. And God said the obedient, the vile women, they guard their husbands. They don't let that happen. In other words, in the vernacular, they watch your back. Can you dig that language? They watch your back. They're not giving nobody no reason to think that there's something going on in your relationship or there's an opportunity, because the wolf, the shaitan, he has no better desire than to destroy your marriage. They sent the jinn out, the jinns went out, and one came back and said that he had done this, and the prophet said, oh, you ain't done nothing. Another one came back and said he had did this and caused this kind of confusion. Shaitan said, oh, you ain't done nothing. Then another one came and said, I came between the husband and wife and I destroyed their marriage. And Shaitan said, yes, yes, this is what we want. Because the foundation of society are good marriages. And if we can destroy the husband and the wife, we can destroy the family. So that's Shaitan's always goal, is to destroy the husband and wife, to put them, to pit them together with one another, have them contending with one another, competing with one another, fighting with one another, arguing with one another. As soon as you start arguing, Allah is not there. Shaitan is there. So when you get married, brothers, try to do everything you can to stay away from argument. Because every time you argue, you get further and further away from your mate. Every time. Let me give you the benefit of my experience, because I'm on my fifth wife. As Imam Muhammad said, I'll get married as often as I need to. But I'm gonna stay married. But now I can give you all, since I had these experiences that a lot of y'all don't have. I'm trying to tell you how to get a wife and then keep a wife. And it's, I recommend to anybody that's getting married, like you would do even more. See, they'll tell you some things that you're going to do that are going to be some of the bigger things you're going to do. And one thing they mentioned is if you buy your first house, that's a big thing, because you don't know the ramifications of real estate. You don't know. So you're going in with the realtor, you're going in with this person, the title company, and that's your first time. So they advise you to get some knowledge of this transaction. Don't just go in there by yourself, right? If you buy a car, now you're going there to a car dealership, especially in the past, and you don't know what's happening, they're going to eat you alive. Your first car, them flim-flam and three cars in the Marley, man, them... Three peas in the pod, niggas gonna beat you like you ain't never got beat before. You gonna be a lawyer or a doctor. They're so well trained, they will still beat you. Because you don't have nobody to support you to tell you how to buy a car. Now, why I make this point? Okay, but then you go out and you meet sister so-and-so, so-and-so, or she meet brother so-and-so, so-and-so, but you think you so fly, think you so smart, think you know so much, you don't want no counseling for that. And the most important thing you're going to do is pick a mate and cohabitate. You see, the Pope don't have no wife, don't you? Pope ain't got time for all that going back and forth and spending all this kind of time. Pope don't ain't got no wife. Pope and the Pope's wife is the church, is the people. But you ain't the Pope. And the problem wasn't the Pope. Pope had a wife. Had wives to take care of his needs and his desires and his wants. Because the prophet was a mortal human being. Mythikun Besharun. A mortal Beshar, mortal sensitive. He just wasn't an ordinary man. He was a sensitive man. Just like you and I. And God said, accept that he was the messenger of God. Don't that make sense? So we married. Man came to the prophet and said, told him how religious he was, and that he had no wife and children. So the prophet said, my community marries. So if you don't marry, you're not in my community. Kept him real. Don't you see me with a wife? I got a wife and children. That's what he was saying. So we can't be no monks, you know, and whatever. We can't do that. That's not our way. And I said, if you find women who part, you feel disloyalty and ill conduct, they said, well, this is the formula, see? This can happen. As to those women whose part you fear, disloyalty and ill conduct, admonish them first. That's the first thing. Warn them. Properly, graciously, etc. But admonish them first. Next, if that don't do it, refuse to share their beds. And last, spank them lightly. And there's a word in the Quran that deals with a blade of grass. And that's how lightly you're supposed to spank them. Like you got a blade of grass. So you're not supposed to hurt them or bruise them or harm them, but you can also spank them with your voice. It's your voice alone. Amen. Muhammad said when he was dealing with one of his wives, when she would get on his nerves, he would go in the kitchen and grab the refrigerator and shake the refrigerator. But he never put his hands on her, never hurt her. But if they return to obedience, seek not against them means of annoyance. For Allah is most high, most gracious. So if you have a problem when you go through them steps, and if they submit, don't come back and keep reminding them about what they did and all that. No, you go through those steps, and if that works, leave it alone and move on. And the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, if a woman don't do right, i.e. your wife, he said, still treat them good. Even if they don't do right, still treat them good. That man was magnanimous. See, if they don't do good, and I said, thought about this just now. How many times you don't do good, and Allah still treat you good? Because of his mercy. Then it said, if you breach, if you fear.
Oh no, we'll be back in 1:30.
Huh? We'll be back in 1:30.
Oh, I thought that was a sign right there.
Yeah, I see
1:30. It says, if you fear a breach between the both of them, meaning it's a split between the husband and the wife, appoint two arbiters. One from his family and the other from hers. And if you wish for peace, Allah will cause that reconciliation. For Allah has power, for Allah has full knowledge, and is acquainted with all things. And that's what I do when I counsel people. See, if you have a problem after you went through these different steps and you go and you take care of your stuff at home first and you can't solve it, then you get the right people to account to counsel you. But you got to go into it because you want peace. You can't go into it because you want to win. You know, she's wrong, you wrong. Can't go in like that. You got to go in it because you still want to be married. If you don't want to be married, there's no sense you going to counseling. You get counseling because there's problems happening, there's things that you all both don't agree on, and you need somebody that's unbiased, somebody that's understands, somebody that knows the religion, and hopefully it's somebody that know you, somebody that know her. And you're going in to try to save the marriage. And Allah said, if you do that, he'll bring about reconciliation. You can't solve the problem. You can't solve it. No matter what you do, you can't solve it. But if you take these steps and go to Allah, and you're trying to find peace, you're trying to keep your family together, then Allah, he will solve the problem. Ain't that something? You can say it all, everything you can do, and it still ain't working. But I found out in my experience as being an imam and counseling many couples, none of you know, because when I counsel somebody, of course, if you are a true imam, you never discuss the conversation you had with nobody to nobody. Never. You never discuss you had counseling to nobody. You didn't tell them you're going to counsel nobody. You don't allude to them. You don't give them no idea. It's purely confidential. But I'm counseling them, I'm going to tell them something. They're going to need to be counseled. Confidential. So I ain't going to play with them. I'm going straight to the mark. So they come to me because they want to be counseled. I'm going to tell them what Allah says and what Allah's messenger said. I'm going to tell them what Imam Muhammad said. I'm going to tell them from my own personal experience. And then they can make the right kind of decision. But if they don't make the right kind of decision, it ain't on me. And they can't say that they weren't counseled effectively and thorough, and then after that, it's on them. So, I guess I'm missing something here. So, if you meet one of my hands, yes. Okay, serve Allah, yeah, serve Allah, and join not any partners with him, and do good to parents, relatives, orphans, those in need, neighbors who are near, the neighbors who are strangers, the companions by your side, the wayfarer you meet, and what your right hand possesses, for Allah loves not the arrogant, the vainglorious. Now you know that we got that going on right now in this Republican Party. The arrogant and the vainglorious, Allah loves not them. And this says you can marry those who your right hand, I said that before, but your right hand possesses, meaning that during the wars, when it was straight up, you had. When you took over the enemy and you took possession of his women, they were lawful for you to marry them. Women that's already there, and other women who were captives. That's your right hand possesses. Allah says, in the last couple of things, Allah forgives not that partnership you set up with him, but he forgives anything else to whom he pleases. To set up partners with Allah is to devise a sin most hideous indeed. So wherever you are, death will find you out. Even if you are in towers, built up strong and high. If some good befalls them, they say this is from Allah. But if evil, they say this is from you, O Prophet. Say all things are from Allah. But what has come to these people that they fail to understand? A single fact. And in my conclusion, If you don't remember anything else I said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in control of everything. If you just remember that, that matter, whatever happens in life to anybody, anywhere in the world, in your family, in your thinking, in your heart, in your mind, in your soul, in your body, whatever happens, Allah is in control of everything. Let's make dua. Rabbana atina fi dunya hasanatan wa fil akhirati hasanatan. Okay, Rabbana. Amen. Rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun. Wa salamun ala mursalin. Alhamdulillah rabbil alamin. Rahim tasalim.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Hayya 'alas-salah, hayya 'alal-falah. Qad qamat as-salah, qad qamat as-salah. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. La ilaha illallah.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين
آمين
إنا أطعنا كوكبا صلي ربك منها إن شاني أخو والأبتا الله سيمي الله لمن حمل الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله